हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम हरे राम, राम राम हरे हरे।
इन्वोकेशन प्रेयर्स।
सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। गीता ध्यानं। ॐ पाठाय प्रतिबोधिनां भगवता नारायणेन स्वयं व्यासेन कृतितां पुराणमुनिना मध्ये महाभारतम् अद्वैतामृतवर्षिणी भगवतीं अष्टादशाध्यायिनी अम्ब त्वामनुसन्धनामि भगवद्गीते भवद्वेषिणी। नमोऽस्तु देव्यास विशालबुद्धे पुल्लारविन्दाय तपत्रनेत्रा येन त्वया भारततल्यपूर्णः प्रज्वालितो ज्ञानमयप्रदीपः प्रपन्नपारिजाताय स्तोत्रवैत्रेकपाणये ज्ञानमुद्राय कृष्णाय गीतामृतदुहे नमः। सर्वोपनिषदो गावो दुग्धा गोपालनन्दनः पार्थो वत्ससुधिर्भोक्ता दुग्धं गीतामृतं महत् वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुं। भीष्मद्रोणतटा जयद्रथजला गान्धारनीलोत्पला शल्यग्राहवती कृपेण वहनी लाकुला अश्वत्थामविकर्णघोरमकरा दुर्योधनावर्तिनी सोतीर्णा खलु पाण्डवैरननदी कैवर्तककेशवः पाराशर्यवचः सरोजमलं गीतार्धघण्टोत्कटं नानाख्यानकेसरं हरिकथा सम्बोधनाबोधितम् लोके सज्जनषट्परैरहरहः पीपीयमानं मुदा भूयाद्भारतपङ्कजं कलिमलप्रध्वंसि न श्रेयसे। मूकं करोति वाचालं पङ्गुं लङ्घयति गिरिं यत्कृपातमहं वन्दे परमानन्दमाधवं यं ब्रह्मावरुणीन्द्ररुद्रमरुतः सुन्वन्ति दिव्यैस्तवैः वेदे साङ्गपदक्रमोपनिषदेर्गायन्ति यं सामगाः ध्यानावस्थिततद्गतेन मनसा पश्यन्ति यं योगिनो यस्यान्तं न विदुःसुरा सुरगणा देवाय तस्मै नमः।
हरि ओम। सो भगवान शोज अस दैट ही इज द वेरी एसेंस ऑफ क्रिएशन। टेक एनीथिंग, or take everything and see what it is because of which that thing is that thing. The pure in all elements, because of which the element is what it is, Bhagavan says, that is me. Take every object and learn the art of seeing Bhagavan in that object. And in this way, discover God. What a beautiful lesson he has taught us. One aspect of the Lord, he also says, right? One aspect of the Lord is apparent. And the other aspect is true. The apparent is the Manigana, the multitude of gems. And the true, the real, is the sutra that ties up all the monies. All aspects of sattva, rajas, tamas, the gunas, have arisen from me alone, he says. But they are in apparent form. In my true nature, they are in me, but I am not in them. Natvaham teshu temai. I am not in them. They are in me. Bhagavan has emphasized that we must learn to go to the source of our thoughts. Source of everything, actually. And of course, our thought is also an element. Don't get carried away by them. Find the essence of why that thought is there. From where the thought is coming. From where anything is coming. What is the true essence? What is their moola? And once you reach there, you have reached the sutra. The world of three gunas is a superimposition on Ishvara, on the para prakriti. The world of apara prakriti, which is made up of the three gunas, is superimposed on the para prakriti or Ishvara. The power of appearing as prakriti is inherent in me, is what Bhagavan says. The meaning, this is the meaning of when he says, I am not in them, they are in me. That the goal of human life is to transcend this perception of the universe being what it is and having this perception of the universe of samsara and to be fixed in the source, in the vision of Ishvara. You would have seen, you know, when we go to these churches, especially in Europe, but a number of churches here, there are these colored glasses that throw this beautiful myriad of beautiful color patterns on the walls opposite them or on the floor or on the ceiling and so on and so forth. Beautiful colored glasses, right? You get quite enamored by them. And we will find that number of us we'll be spending more time looking at those beauties and the architectural marvel of these churches and less time sitting in front of God and praying to God in the church. Similarly, people of the world get carried away by that Maya and do not see Bhagavan in the substratum or as the substratum. And now Bhagavan continues. We will go to verse 13 of 7th chapter.
त्रिभिर् गुणमयैर् भावैः
एभिः सर्वमिदं जगत्
मोहितं नाभिजानाति
मामेभ्यः परमव्ययम्
त्रिभिर् गुणमयैर् भावैः एभिः सर्वमिदं जगत् मोहितं नाभिजानाति मामेभ्यः परमव्ययम्
सो एभिः सर्वमिदं जगत् एभिः मीन्स् बै दीस् बै वाट् बै त्रिभिः गुणमयैः सो दीस् त्री एक्स्प्रेशन्स् दट् आर् कम्पोस्ड् आफ् गुणास् गुणमयी कम्पोस्ड् आफ् गुणास् By these, which is what? Which is bhavaihi, my nature. That is my nature. Sarva idam jagat, all this world, all beings are deluded, mohitam. So Bhagavan essentially is saying that these three expressions, the sattva, rajas, tamas, which is nothing but my bhava, my guna, through those, the entire world is deluded. All the beings in the world are deluded. And as a result of this delusion, na abhijanati, do not know. What do they do not know? Mamebhyah paramavyayam. Mam, me, as different from the prakriti, maya, and as param avyayam, supreme, param avyayam, imperishable, immutable. So by being deluded in the maya, which is superimposed above the substratum, which is the real Bhagwan, the world is deluded and does not see Bhagwan, who is the supreme and the immutable. So being their cause, I am superior to these entities, which are comprised of sattva, rajas, tamas. I am their cause, and hence I am superior. And while they are change-oriented, while they decay, while they perish, I am changeless, I am decayless, I do not decay, and imperishable. Param avyayam. Picture the scene of a baby, a small baby on a mother's lap. Okay. And the mother has long hair. And the mother is covering her face with the hair. And she covers the face in the hair, the baby cries out. And then the mother removes the hair from the face and the baby laughs. So the mother covers the face, the baby cries out, removes the hair from the face, reveals her face, the baby laughs. As many times as she does this, the baby cries and the face is covered, and the baby laughs when the face is revealed. A lot of us play this game also, no? Instead of hair, we use our hands, right? Such a nice game that we all play with these babies. How significant that episode of such game with the baby, you know, as soon as a baby is born and can perceive, how Bhagwan has created that game, which is nothing but the entire reality of what it is. That simple game. So this baby knows very clearly that this woman, this lady is his mother. The baby is very secure in her lap. Completely understands where the baby is. The baby knows very well. The minute you transform the baby to somebody else's lap, maybe even the father, the baby does not like it. Wants to be with the mother. That security, that peace, in that calmness in that face of the baby that comes from that security is very obvious to all of us. We'll say, okay, go back to your mother. We all do that, right? The baby knows where he is, but he plays this game completely deluded. That is exactly what happens in the world. We all are secure in the grasp of Bhagwan, yet we seek him in temples and elsewhere. His sattva, rajas, tamas nature, that is what we seek while we are secure in his grasp. And we seek it in a deluded manner. A constant ongoing dialogue between me and my mother, you know, is based on this. So is her insistence on gaining happiness by visiting temples, by seeing TV shows, you know, which are on Bhagwan. At the end of the day, it's a TV show, by the way. Remember that. Maya. Complete Maya. It's not real. You'll see Tirupati Aarti, you know, on the TV. It's not even real Tirupati. Forget about being real God. Okay. Constant dialogue between them. That happiness that she gets. While I hope that day will come, one day, she would be fully happy, knowing fully well that indeed he alone is holding her all through the time, wherever she may be, whether she's in Tirupati or Srirangam or sitting in the drawing room or watching him on TV, wherever she may be, that she is indeed in his grasp. The sattva, the rajas and the tamas all have vyaya. Vyaya means they perish. they have decay. Vyaya actually means decay. One decays, the other comes up. The other decays, the third guna comes up. So they keep playing this game alternatingly. Sattva decays, rajas comes up. Rajas decays, sattva comes up. Sattva decays, tamas comes up. Tamas decays, rajas comes up. So that all, every element of creation is composed of the three gunas. We will see this later also when Bhagavan covers the three gunas in detail. All, there are permutation combination of all three of them in every one, in every creation, every aspect. And one decays and the other emerges as the dominant. But Bhagavan is Paramavyayam, supreme, immutable, higher than all else, including himself in the Maya form, in the temples also. So Bhagavan is actually asking us to take our attention away from his apara prakriti and fix it in his para prakriti. And he will also tell us how to do this. But first, he himself acknowledges that it is indeed very difficult. It is not an easy thing to do. We will see that in the next verse.
Daivi hesha gunamai. Mama maya duratyaya.
Mama maya duratyaya.
Mame vaye prapadyante.
Mame vaye prapadyante.
Mayametam tarantite.
Mayametam tarantite.
Daivi hesha gunamai. Mama maya duratyaya. Mame vaye prapadyante. Mayametam tarantite.
Bhagavan says hesha. Hesha means indeed. Indeed, this. What is this? What is this hesha? This that we experience non-stop. In fact, there is a seva in Tirupati, Tirumalai, you know, which is Udayastamana Seva. Non-stop, morning till evening. Udaya Astamana Seva. They have made a seva because of this experience that we have continuously. Gunamayi. This is made up of gunas. Gunamayi. And he says, Mama, this is my Daivi Maya. This is my divine illusion. The experience in Sattva, Rajas, Tamas, this experience of Maya, this experience of Prakriti. Remember, we saw in the creation, right? The first aspect of Prakriti, which is Maya. They are all divine illusions of Bhagavan, is what Bhagavan says. Daivi comes from Deva. And Deva comes from the root Va. Va means to shine. And the changeless substratum, Deva, is behind the changing illusion, Maya. And being behind the changing illusion of Maya is veiled by Maya. The ashrayaha or substratum of Maya is Deva or consciousness, the pure consciousness. And the vishaya or subject that this Maya is unveiling is also Deva or pure consciousness, Bhagavan. Staying in consciousness, it veils the consciousness. What? Maya. So Maya, which is at the top of creation, is what Bhagavan says, Gunamayi. It triggers. Gunamayi is something that triggers the gunas. It triggers sattva, rajas and tamas. And by triggering sattva, rajas and tamas, it deludes. When it triggers knowledge and devotion, we call it sattva. When it triggers dynamism and action, we call it rajas. When it triggers shoka, sorrow and moha, sorrow and delusion, shoka and moha, we call it tamas. Guna also means rope in Sanskrit. Guna, another meaning for rope is guna. And this rope, which is kind of tied up, intertwined by three ropes, three small ropes intertwined. You see, when they want to make a rope stronger, you intertwine multiple smaller ropes to make it stronger. You don't create one big rope, okay? That's not as strong. You create small ropes and then you intertwine them and create a stronger rope. This guna, which is composed of these three ropes of sattva, rajas and tamas, is extremely strong. It binds, it holds. And Bhagavan says, this is mama maya. This is my illusion. This strong thing which is holding you is mama maya. This mama maya is not a villain, by the way. Let's not think that, oh, it's not bad. It is also the nature of Bhagavan. It is also him. And Bhagavan says, duratyaya, it is very difficult to cross. Atyaya means to cross over, like jumping over a river, a small stream. Duratyaya, dura is difficult, extremely difficult. It's very difficult to cross. So Bhagavan makes this admission first. It is my maya and it is very difficult to cross. So how does one cross? How does one prevent maya from triggering sattva, from triggering rajas, from triggering tamas? How does one do that? What is the method that God teaches us to help us achieve this? So Bhagavan says this through the example of people who have achieved it. He says, te is they. Te taranti etam. They who cross over. Taranti is crossover. They who cross over etam mayam, this illusion, they who cross over this illusion, ye mameva prapantyante, are those who in me alone take refuge. So Bhagavan gives a very simple way of crossing over this maya, is to take full 100% refuge in mam, in me alone. What is this mam that he's referring to? The substratum, the para prakriti. Shift your attention from apara prakriti and fix it wholly and completely and fully on the para prakriti. From my maya, shift to me. And thereby, you will be able to cross over this maya that is so difficult to prosecute. The concept of prapatti or surrender, this involves surrender to the grace of Bhagavan, evolved from this prapatyante, where Bhagavan says prapatyante, mam prapatyante. That is where the concept of prapatti or surrender evolved. According to Vedanta Desika philosophy, prapatti requires some effort on the part of the person who is worshipping. Just as the baby monkey must hold on to its mother when the mother is carrying. So the baby monkey has to put in some effort. If the baby monkey's grip goes, she is going to fall. So just as the baby monkey, it's called Markata Nyaya. Just as the baby monkey has to put an effort to hold on to the mother monkey, similarly, human beings have to put in some effort. According to the Vedanta, there are other philosophies also. Okay, here I am giving this example because prapatti is discussed maximum there. So there are six ways in which this effort is to be put according to the Vedanta Desika philosophy. The first one is anukulasya sankalpa, sankalpam, which means accepting things that are favorable for enabling devotion to Bhagavan. So we have to first accept those things. For example, we should have a small murti of Bhagavan, or we should have a small temple at home. We should light the diya. All these cultures come from there because they are elements which create favorable environment to perform worship. So accepting this, in fact, very important in today's world where most people reject things which are favorable. And what does the second point say? Pratikulyasya varjanam. Rejecting those that are not favorable, that are averse to surrender to God. See, surrender is very important. If nothing else in the modern concept, I hope I remember this correctly because I wrote this sometime back. See, in today's world, why do we have to pray? Why do we have to surrender? Number one, because it gives us humility. Okay, and humility is required to succeed in today's world. I am personally familiar of n number of highly accomplished people, extremely well-studied, well-read, but not humble. They have an air, you know, they think they know it all. Unfortunately, when that happens, success stops. See, as a student or as a young professional, why did you do well? Because you were humble. But once you started achieving, and you know, awards and accolades piled on, that humility gets veiled. And when that humility gets veiled by your own ego, that same success that you could get goes away. So humility is number one. That's the reason one should surrender. Because you surrender to what? You surrender to something bigger. When you surrender to something bigger, you are humble. When you are humble, you don't get carried away by your own achievements and accolades and what you think you're capable of. So that is the number one reason why one should pray. The other reason that one should pray is very simple. We have read it so many times in Bhagavad Gita, that second and the third reason. The second and the third reason why one should pray are Chitta Shuddhi, Chitta Ekagrata. Prayer enables Chitta Shuddhi. If you pray, the mind gets cleaner, purer. The sins in the mind. What are sins? Sins are disturbances in the mind. What are disturbances? The shadrupas. Kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madha, matsarya. When you pray, the kama, krodha, lobha, the quantum of those in your mind, at least they, if they don't go away, they reduce drastically. Drastically reduce. I do that whenever I have some kind of these shadrupas. Just simply, if you say Hanuman Chalisa, once the Hanuman Chalisa is over, you are in a completely different frame of mind. And actually much better. You realize that it is better than what it was earlier. So it's not like we human beings don't have sattva, rajas, tamas. All of us have. But this is the technique to overcome. Surrender. Before surrender, prayer, worship. The third is chitta ekagratha. You are able to have the single-pointed focus. And we saw earlier, when we did chapter 6, that single pointed focus is required for us to be able to meditate. Without that single pointedness, we will not be able to meditate. We will not be able to focus on anything. Meditate on anything. Let us start by meditating on hitting the tennis ball. Or let us start by, let's say now IPL season. You have to, that Virat Kohli has to absolutely look at that small red ball coming at him for him to be able to hit us. Imagine his vision goes half a degree to the left, either it's going to hit. Like yesterday, you know, the first IPL match, I don't know who all you saw, I was watching. He's holding a catch, the ball is coming to him at great speed. He missed it, you know, the ball bounced off his hand and hit him here. He's got a nice round swelling there, just below his, imagine it had got to his eye. So you have to focus on that small little red ball. You cannot afford to focus on this 360 degree that's surrounding you. Anything requires chitta. And of course, meditation requires chitta ekagrata. And of course, worship requires chitta ekagrata. So, anukula sankalpam, to surround yourself with elements that are favorable to prayer, and pratikulasya varjitam, to reject those which are averse to this surrender, this ability to surrender. The third element is Rakshishyatiti Mahavishwasam. Considering God to be one's protector in and under all circumstances. Rakshishyatiti Mahavishwasam. That you say, Bhagwan, you are my protector. That's it. I believe that. Under every single circumstance. The fourth one is Goptritva Varanam. Accepting God as one's maintainer. It's not the salary that I earn that maintains me. It is Bhagwan who enables that. Karpanyam, that's the fifth one. Creating and nurturing a feeling of absolute humility towards Bhagwan. Earlier it was, when I talked about humility, that comes from prayer automatically. Here you are making an effort to, Karpanyam is to make that effort to become humble. That is a very important element of surrender. And the last one is Atma Nikshepam. Atma Nikshepam means you are completely surrendering. That's it. Simple step. Surrendering everything in God's lotus feet, in his service or her service. But if this is so, then why is it that everyone does not take recourse to Bhagwan and to worshipping Bhagwan and to surrender? Forget about all that. Why doesn't today's generation take recourse to prayer? Today, my niece went inside the temple we have. Okay, I said, wow, hey, I just noticed you're coming out. I said, what happened? Why did you go inside? She said to see that they had bought mango and, you know, they sell mango in our locality. So that dabba, whatever it's called, the carton was there. So to see the price, she went into the, I said, oh my, I thought you'd gone to pray. So this aspect of prayer on a day-to-day basis, to at least get those three worldly benefits. Let's forget about meditation and, you know, worship and Bhagwan and all of that. Just the three worldly benefits. The aspect of being humble, cleaner and purer mind that removes all the disturbances. Our mind feels better without disturbances, and the ability to focus on whatever we do, on the white ball, as OP sir wrote. So at least for that, we'll come to meditation and all of that later, because a person who does this will get into meditation at some stage in life. Guarantee. And a person who gets into meditation will get into worship later in life. Guarantee. That's a guarantee. So at least the first step we can take. Like that baby monkey that holds on to the Bhagwan. So why don't people do that? Bhagwan says in the next verse.
Namam duskriti no mudaha.
Namam duskriti no mudaha.
Prapadyante naradamaha.
Prapadyante naradamaha.
Mayaya prahrita jnanaha.
Mayaya prahrita jnanaha.
Asuram bhava mashritaha.
Asuram bhava mashritaha.
Namam duskriti no mudaha. Prapadyante naradamaha. Mayaya prahrita jnanaha. Asuram bhava mashritaha.
So Bhagwan says, let's first see the words, right, before we go. Namam duskriti no mudaha. Not to me. We'll come about what he's saying, not to me. The duskriti no mudaha, the evil doer, the deluded. Prapatyante naradamaha. They, not to me, they seek. They do not seek me. The naradamaha, the lowest among people, is what Bhagwan is saying here. We'll explain that. Okay. People who don't pray today are not the lowest among people or evildoer. Okay. I know my niece is a very, very, very nice person. Maybe a little bit deluded. That I can agree. Then Bhagwan says, Mayaya pakhrita jnanaha. By maya, mayaya, by my maya, pakhrita jnana, deprived of knowledge. Deprived of knowledge by that veiling. So some of the good people are also deprived of this knowledge by that veil of maya. Asuram bhava mashritaha. Asuram, belonging to demons, have taken to that nature, that bhavam, ashritaha have taken to. But if you consistently don't submit, then all these things will happen to every human being. Consistently over a period of lifetime, do not submit to the higher force, to the higher ideal. We can choose what our higher ideal is. But when we choose what our higher ideal is, my favorite example, Federer, when he chooses that tennis as his higher ideal, he develops a submissive attitude. Because he has done that over 1 year, 2 years, 20 decades of submission to that higher ideal, automatically brings in that attitude of humility. So as we just saw, the ability to acquire the capacity to be able to put full attention on Bhagwan, that Chitta Ekagrata, that requires prior effort. Just to get this ability, to get that capacity, to be able to have Chitta Ekagrata, that requires prior effort. Lack of prior effort disables a person from this capacity. Without effort, it takes effort to even pray. That is why Bhagwan has also taught us Karma Yoga, by the way, as well, one of the greatest form of prayer. Even if we do our work with prayer, with the attitude of, you know, Ishwararpana Buddhi, Prasada Buddhi. So even if we do our, we don't have to go into Bhagwan's room and pray at an idol, at a statue. No. Bhagwan says, has given infinite ways to pray. Infinite ways to submit, to worship. So even if we do our work with submitting to the higher power, even if we take whatever comes after we do our work as a benevolence of the higher, that's good enough. That's prayer. So when you don't do that, when a person does not do that, it disables the person from building this capacity. And it leads to evil deeds, as Bhagwan terms it, dushkritinaha. It leads to that. Obviously, when you miss a good shot, or when you, you know, you've seen John McEnroe on court, the way he yells and abuses, that is one element of quote-unquote evil deed, right? When you are so frustrated because you have not paid attention, because you have not practiced, because all that's all what Bhagwan is calling prayer. And when you don't do that, you get annoyed. You get annoyed means chitta ashuddhi. Chitta ashuddhi leads to evil act. Evil can be murder, or evil can be an abuse, whatever it may be. People who perform such deeds are of four types, is what Bhagwan has covered in this verse. Additionally, these dushkritinaha, they kind of, it's like Bhagwan talks about this spiral, downward spiral, where you go from one level to even lower. So either you can view it as four different types, or you can view it as a downward spiral, one leading to the other. So the dushkritinaha, the evil doer, the performer of evil action, let's put it that way, whatever the nature of that evil action is, those who commit evil deeds, and because of these, they have collected disturbances, enormous amount of sins, which is nothing but the disturbance in their own mind. Swami Chinmayanandaji used to refer to this as self-insulting action. Self-insulting action. And because of that, they are, what are the four? Number one, Bhagwan says, Mudaha, deluded. Those who have misconceptions about Bhagwan, and because of that, they think that their personal joy or whatever they are getting is not dependent on any high power. So let us say, you know, our Nadal goes to win the French Open now, it's going to come now. Or let's say, you know, RCB wins the IPL, and the team, Virat Kohli, Nadal, they all believe that I got it, you know, I played, I got it. You don't have that devotion to your own game, the game of cricket, the game of tennis, your work, the work that you have put in. You don't consider that as an higher ideal. You think I got it. That is Mudaha. People who think that their joys are not dependent on Bhagwan. The second is Naradamaha. Naradamaha, Bhagwan says, Nara, human beings. Adamaha, lowest among the human beings. through their own actions, they are not even fit to be called a human being. Those are the Naradamas. Not even fit to be called human beings. The only thing that makes a person higher or lower is their action that they perform. It is not their color, their race, their sex, their caste, their creed, the amount of money they have, their position in society, the title in the office. That does not make people higher or lower. The only thing that can make people higher or lower is their action. And through your action, if the human being is doing something that not even fit to be called a human being, that person is a Naradama. And then Mayaya Prathyana. Mayaya, by Maya, they get deprived of the knowledge. Aprihat jnana. Deprived of knowledge through Maya. So they have the knowledge of Bhagwan. They understand what prayer is. They understand what his manifestations are. They understand, they may not know the term, but they understand Paraprakriti, Aparaprakriti. They get it. But they are moved by deceitful reasoning. Their logic, the reasoning, is deceiving them only. Their own logic and reasoning deceives them to contend that such knowledge is impossible. It's inconsistent. It doesn't make sense. What higher power? There's no higher power. Okay, maybe there is science. Maybe there is something else. But no, there's no power. It deceives them to believe that way. They are the Mayaya Pakhrita Jnanaha, who deceive themselves to think that there is no higher power. They are aware of it, but logically they argue against it. And then Asuram Bhavamashritaha, those who have the knowledge of Bhagwan, again, this category also, you have the knowledge of Bhagwan, have the knowledge of his two natures, all that you know, but they hate Bhagwan. They hate him. It's contrast to the previous one, which does not believe in him, logically does not believe. This category hates him. And because you hate Bhagwan, you take recourse to demonic actions. And Bhagwan says, Namam Pradyante. These categories of people, they do not seek me. And they end up being Dushkritinaha. They end up doing evil deeds. These kind of people who are evil doers, and who are of these types and get into this, downward spiral, they cannot surrender to me. They lose the capability to surrender. In chapter 16, Bhagwan details out the divine virtues that one should practice and the demonic tendencies that one should curtail, get away from. It's called Daivasura Sampad Vibhaga Yoga. There, Bhagwan says, Dambho Darpo Bhimanascha Krodha Parushya Mevacha Agnanam Cha Bhijatasya Partha Sampada Masurim. So, Bhagwan there lists out qualities. And those qualities are hypocrisy, arrogance, Dambha Darpa, Abhimana Darpa, self-conceit, anger, harshness, ignorance, as those qualities belonging to asuras. And when the type of people, the three types, the evildoers, the three that we saw, the deluded, the lowest among humans, and those who are deprived of the knowledge because of Maya, and those who think that Bhagwan is a They hate Bhagwan. So those four types, in addition to being those types, because of your guna, you also develop these qualities that Bhagwan will talk about in chapter 16. Then they start relishing their demonic actions, their own behavior. They find pleasure in doing those demonic actions. All of it starts with performance. We'll see a couple of examples by the way. All of this starts with performance of actions which are unbecoming of human beings. Hence, correction is required where? Because it starts with actions that are unbecoming, correction is required in actions and convert them into becoming. If it does, if that correction is implemented, then it leads to refinement. If it does not, it leads to perishment. And infamy, even after perishing, after that also it leads to infamy. So Bhagavan doesn't completely condemn people who are, you know, because of sattva, rajas, tamas, something wrong has been done. Bhagavan doesn't condemn that. He says, please change your action. Please refine, come back. If you don't refuse to do that, then it will lead to perishing. Adolf Hitler ruled Germany on the principle of Führerprinzip. That was his principle. The principle means absolute obedience of subordinate to the superior. And he himself was that infallible top guy, the superior most at the apex. His political agenda brought about a world war. Okay. And what did that world war do? Left behind an impoverished Europe and a devastated world. That's what it did. His policies inflicted human suffering at an unprecedented scale, including killing an estimated 20 million people, civilians and prisoners of war. And this was in addition to an estimated 30 million people during the war, soldiers and civilians and all of those. That was his political agenda was different, and his policies, everything was demonic in nature. Finally, Hitler died through committing suicide at an age of 56, after having led a demonic life. Didn't change till his very end. Till his very end, the guy refused to change. Maricha is a demon. We know as a demon. You know, we have come across in the Ramayana. Had multiple encounters with Sri Rama. First, he tormented Sage Vishwamitra when Rama, Lakshmana, they were all children. And Vishwamitra had to go to Ayodhya, request Dasharatha to send his princes to protect him when he was doing all his austerities. So Maricha and the demon gang came. Rama fired arrows at them, killed all of them. One arrow struck Maricha on his chest, and it is said, legend goes, that he was thrown leagues away into the ocean. That arrow carried him hundreds of leagues away into the ocean. Then later on, one more encounter when Rama, Sita, Lakshmana were in exile, Maricha comes and attacks them along with other demons. Rama kills all the demons and Maricha scoots. He runs away because he has had that experience of being thrown 100 leagues. Imagine a bolt hits you and you get thrown out. So you know you're very careful. That bolt of Rama, he runs away, he scoots. Thus pardoned in a way, in a manner, thus pardoned or, you know, spared, Maricha was transformed. And he lived the life of an ascetic after that, completely transformed. And then one fine day, Ravana beckons him. I need your help. I've heard about this beautiful lady called Sita. You need to disguise yourself as the golden deer and help me kidnap her. You have to lure away Rama and Lakshmana so that I can kidnap, abduct Sita. Maricha says, Ravana, don't do this. It's not a good idea. In fact, the second story that I gave of Maricha attacking Rama Lakshmana in the exile is not covered in the Ramayana. It is covered as a story that Maricha tells Ravana to dissuade him. Hey, I did this and, you know, I was beaten away. It's not possible. He's not a human being. He's Bhagavan. Don't mess with him. Don't do. And what your idea is wrong. Why do you want to abduct his wife? Don't do it. Ravana said, you bloody well do it or I'm going to kill you. And then Maricha says, it is better to die in Sri Rama's hand than your hand, Ravana. I will might as well do one more sin before I die and die in Ravana's hand. So he is a transformed. So Bhagavan says, gives a chance to even to demons, even to the asuras. We'll come to that later, like I said in chapter 16. You know, he'll talk about detail. How you can get transformed wherever, whichever stage of evolution that we are in. And in contrast to the Dushkritinaha is that of the life of a Sukritinaha. And Bhagavan talks about them in the next verse.
चतुर्विधा भजन्ति माम
चतुर्विधा भजन्ति माम
जनासुकृतिनोर्जुना आर्तो जिज्ञासुरर्थार्थी ज्ञानी च भरतर्षभा चतुर्विधा भजन्ति माम जनासुकृतिनोर्जुना आर्तो जिज्ञासुरर्थार्थी ज्ञानी च भरतर्षभा
चतुर्विधा फोर काइंड्स ऑफ व्हाट सुकृतिनः जनः वर्चुअस पीपल भजन्ते माम वर्शिप मी ओ अर्जुन फोर काइंड्स ऑफ वर्चुअस पीपल वर्शिप मी ओ अर्जुन एक्शन इज अ क्रूसिबल ऑन विच ह्यूमन बीइंग्स इवॉल्व और ह्यूमन बीइंग्स डिवॉल्व आइदर गो अप और गो डाउन whichever spiral we choose. The virtuous people who through many janmas of noble actions, they have cultivated punya. Punya is what? Punya is a mind without shadrupu. A mind that is cleaner, purer, calmer. Sometimes we find a young baby also, like my son, I can tell you, you know, from the child time, he's been a small baby before he could speak till today. There's some calmness in him. He was born calm. There has to be something, no? Whereas I am a lot more rajasic, okay? My nature. I am like pakka, my son's name is Prahlad. I am Hiranyakashipu to Prahlad. Lot more rajasic. So, how are you born calm? How are you born prodigy? Right? You are born calm, you are born prodigy. How does that happen? Because of the punya that you have accumulated through your own actions in various life, where the soul comes with that benefit. Remember, we talked about one example was Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, and another example was Vivekananda. Bhagavan says that based on your karma, based on your actions, based on your punya, you gain birth at the appropriate place. So please don't worry, Arjuna, you don't lose anything if the life goes away. So because of this punya, they are able to surrender to Bhagavan. These people are of four kinds. Three of those four kinds are sakami. Sakami means those who perform actions with desire. The fourth is the nishkama. People who perform actions free of any desire. All four are able to surrender. Even people who perform actions with kama are able to surrender. Now, who are these virtuous people? Artha. Artha means the distressed. Arthi means sorrow. Thus, one who is afflicted by sorrow is an artha. Extreme distress that causes mental afflictions. Draupadi was relaxing in her palace while the Pandavas were playing dice. She was in a calm, peaceful mind, having a good time at just relaxing, chilling, as we say. Within minutes, she was dragged into the court. And there, an attempt was made to disrobe her. Within about 3, 4, 5 minutes, from a calm, serene mindset to a mindset of extreme distress. Who? Draupadi. What did she do? She just implored with extreme distress, incomparable pain, unimaginable pain. She sought Bhagavan. She was an artha. A less severe situation for the same Draupadi, by the way. So, no, let's not talk about that level of extreme, right? A less severe situation for the same Draupadi. Another story. When the Pandavas were in exile, they used to receive a number of visitors. Okay. And these visitors used to come to them for mainly two reasons. One, to take advice, guidance from them. Because Pandavas are known to be great. You know, I mean, between the five of them, every single art of ruling a country to whatever, to do whatever was with them among the five. So to take advice, guidance, and to express solidarity, to express support. And Draupadi was very particular that whoever came, you will be fed nicely so that you are satisfied. Like you say, no, when your guest comes, make sure the guest is satisfied, leave satisfied, tripta. So Draupadi was very particular about that. But what do you do in the forest when you're in exile? As a princess in the palace, absolutely. As a queen in the palace, absolutely possible. Here, it is said that Surya Bhagwan gave her what we know as Akshaya Patra. The Akshaya Patra is something that gives, that can provide unending supply of food. And Surya Bhagwan has told her that till you should be the last person to eat. Anyway, Draupadi was the last person to eat. She always was the last person to eat. So Bhagwan Surya said, after you eat, the patra will get over. After that, you will not get food. Now Duryodhana knew this. So obviously Duryodhana was always scheming to put Pandavas in trouble. So Durvasa, sage Durvasa, he was visiting Hastinapura, and Duryodhana looked after sage Durvasa and his entourage extremely well. Durvasa, mighty pleased, said, ask whatever you want. In those days, we said boon, right? So ask whatever you want. And Duryodhana said, I know what I want. Like you came here, Maharishi, please go to Pandavas. And please go after so and so time, after Draupadi has had food. If you go and Draupadi has not had food, please go out sometime, have a bath, come back after she has had food, and then ask her. So Duryodhana's scheme is that Durvasa will get angry, curse them. They themselves will feel bad and cursed, and so on and so forth, right? So Durvasa goes, he has granted a boon, so he can't say no. He and his entourage go there to Pandavas. So they go there, and Durvasa tells Draupadi, please keep food ready for all of us. We'll take a bath in the river and come back. And Draupadi is absolutely flabbergasted. There's no food. She's had her food. And she implores Krishna, please, Bhagwan, save me from this situation. Immediately, Krishna appears. And he says, Draupadi, I'm feeling extremely hungry. Please give me food. Draupadi says, exasperated, you know, I called you because I need help, because I don't have food, and you are asking for it. Just, I can smell something. Give me your patra. And there is one grain of rice and a little bit of kira, vegetable. And he takes that and he says, ah, thank you. I'm very, very satisfied. And Bhagwan, being satisfied, satiated all of the Durvasa and his entourage, all of them. And they said, no need for any food. They went. That's how he took care of Draupadi in that situation. So, artha is when you are in distress and you seek out the noble people, the virtuous people in distress, seek out to Bhagavan. The second type is jigyasu. Jigyasu is one who seeks knowledge, one who wants knowledge, especially the mumukshu, meaning especially the one who is seeking Bhagavan, one who is seeking knowledge, knowledge of the self and the ways and means to worship Bhagavan. That seeker, that knowledge seeker, especially that, but all kinds of knowledge seekers. One who wants to tread the spiritual path, especially. Arjuna is prime example of this. Remember when we started Bhagavad Gita about, you know, at the beginning, Yachve yashyam nishchitam bruhi tanme shishyasteham shadimam tvam prapanna. What is surely, permanently, decisively good for me? Oh Krishna, I am your disciple, I am your student, I surrender to you, please teach me. And then he keeps asking Bhagwan again and again, please tell me decisively, please teach me decisively. The seeker of knowledge, jigyasu. Artharthi is literally, artharthi means a person who seeks wealth. It figuratively also implies a person who seeks all the comforts and enjoyments of life. That is artharthi, also a virtuous person. A beautiful story to depict artharthi. You know, this young boy was playing on his father's lap and his stepmother pushes him away. This is not your place, and puts her son in his place. This is Dhruva. Dhruva, the son of King Uttanapada, he was stunned and he protested. To which his stepmother said, get out of here, ask God. This kingdom and the lap is not yours. Whatever you want, you can ask God. The young boy Dhruva, he took it literally, seriously. And he started praying to God, praying to Bhagwan. And he prayed so hard that the heavens started trembling. You know, that's the level of penance and austerity that he reached. And finally, Vishnu appeared before Dhruva. But even when Vishnu appeared Dhruva, he didn't acknowledge. Because he was so intensely deep into his meditation, into his inner mental vision of Bhagwan, that level of chitta ekagrata, that he didn't realize that God himself was standing in front of him. So finally, Vishnu had to, please note, this has a reason, that vision, that inner vision and outer vision. Vishnu had to erase the inner vision of Dhruva. And only when Vishnu erased the inner vision of Dhruva, Dhruva opened his eyes. And he saw outside what he had seen inside. The same was there also. And then Vishnu asked him, what can I give you? What can I do for you? And Dhruva was so deep into what he was, the meditation, that he forgot the goal. By the way, his goal was what? The kingdom, the throne, the lap, father's lap. But he forgot about it. And he said, Bhagavan, I want to live a life of meditating on you. That is what I want. So Bhagavan gave him that. Because he had got that, people gave him the throne, everybody, including his stepmother. And Vishnu also gave him the status of Dhruvapada. That is why the pole star is named Dhruva. May you show the vision, the right direction to people who are seekers. So this is the Artharthi, people who seek, and people who seek things that will make them comfortable, and through that learn to seek. And how do they do through that learn to seek Bhagwan? The Artha is one who wants to be free of Dukkha. Draupadi wanted to be free. I mean, that was a tremendous amount of Dukkha for her, right? Artha is a person who wants to be free of Dukkha. Remove the Dukkha that I have got. Bhagwan, you're asking that. An Artharthi is one who says, Bhagwan, please give me the Sukha. I want Sukha. A Jigyasu is one who wants to rise above both Dukkha and Sukha. So these are people who surrender in order to fulfill desires. They are Sakami. Both the Arthi or Artha and Artha and Artharthi, both of them become Jigyasu. Or they evolve into becoming Jigyasu. By the way, the Jigyasu also can become one of the other two, Artha or Artharthi. That is also possible. Like my Guruji gives a very example of, you know, he became took the life of becoming a saint. And in one of the classes, you know, you have exams. Like even when I did my Bhagavad Gita course, there is exam for after every chapter. You have to write the exam. So as a brahmachari who is on the way to becoming sannyasi, you have given up anything. What are you? You are a jigyasu. A sannyasi is a jigyasu. A person who is seeking to become a sannyasi is a jigyasu. But there in the Vaiva voice, they said, Swamiji, please answer. His name was called out and he's like, Bhagwan, please protect me. What is that? Is that jigyasu? Oh, I have to give the right answer. That is Artharthi. So Jigyasu can also become Artharthi. So people who seek Bhagwan with the goal of a desire to be fulfilled. And finally, Artha Artharthi become Jigyasu. Jigyasu then can become the fourth type, who are virtuous people who are Nishkama. Nishkama Bhakta. They are the Jnani. The Jnani are those Nishkama Bhaktas. Of what? Jnani of what? What does this person know? This person knows Sutre Manigana Iva. Knows the difference between the Sutra and the Manigana. That knowledge is what Bhagavan is referring to here. the difference between the apara prakriti and the para prakriti. And because of this knowledge goes beyond the maya to the Lord, to Bhagwan. Arjuna once asked Sri Krishna after the war was won and all of that. So he asked Bhagwan, he says, why is it that the gopis are considered the best among devotees? So Krishna says, you go find out. Let me tell you, this is so and so gopi, lives here. Go and meet her. You will find out for yourself. So Arjuna goes. When he enters her kutiya, he sees an old lady, aged gopi, who is sitting there, eyes closed, meditating. And Arjuna obviously has to wait, right, for the meditation to get over. Once it gets over, but before that, he sees that in front of, some of you may have heard this beautiful story. In front of this old aged gopi meditating is a sword. And Arjuna is like, why is this old lady meditating, you know, gopi? Why is she having a sword? Anyway, the gopi opens her eyes and Arjuna, you know, Jai Sri Krishna, pleasantries, all that exchange. What are you doing? You're meditating. You do this. All that is, you know, loose talk over. He says, comes to the question, why do you have this sword in front of you? So the gopi says, that is to kill these two fellows. And Arjuna says, who are these two fellows? Yeah, one of them is Draupadi. And Arjuna says, what? Draupadi? You want to kill Draupadi? That noble, nice lady. Why do you want to kill Draupadi? By the way, Arjuna's wife. Why do you want to kill her? He says, you know, I mean, this woman, Bhagwan was in heaven. He was sitting. He was enjoying his food. He was eating. And these wicked fellows, they were taking off her clothes. You know, they were doing this nonsense work, wicked work. And she has to call Bhagwan and disturb my Bhagwan. That too, while he's having food, she has to be punished. So one person is that. Why disturb, for your trouble, you are disturbing Bhagwan. You can't do that. Oh my God. Okay, so who is the second person that you want to kill? That idiot, that wicked Arjuna. It's worse than Draupadi. Draupadi, Firpi, it's okay. You know, this Arjuna is the worst. And Arjuna is like, you know, she doesn't know he's Arjuna. And he's like, why Arjuna? He's a friend of Krishna, bhakta of Krishna. Why would you say you want to kill him? That's such a useless fellow. He, you know what he did? He made Bhagwan his charioteer. Imagine what kind of a man will make Bhagwan. My Bhagwan, he made him his charioteer. You know, he had to clean his horses. And the impudence of this Arjuna, how dare he order my Bhagwan? Take my Ratham to the middle of the battlefield. How dare he gives this impudent order to my Bhagwan? He has to be punished. Senayor Ubyor Madhye, Ratham Stapet Mechuta. What does he think of himself? And look at my poor Bhagwan, you know, Nihatta in front of Arjuna, how many arrows he would have taken on himself because of this Arjuna. He needs to be killed. Arjuna ran, scooted from there. So, Nishkama Bhakta. The first three place God on a pedestal and ask him for this, ye de do, wo de do, give me this, give me that. There's this song, you know, that I've heard long time back. So they put him on a pedestal, by the way. Teri hi zameen, tera asman, tu bada meherban. Uske baad, bakshish kar, sabhi ka hai tu, sabhi tere, khuda mere, tu bakshish kar. So put Bhagwan in a pedestal, then ask him. ये भी दे दो वो भी दे दो अब ये दे दिया तो कुछ और भी दे दो ओ भगवान द ज्ञानी नोइंग फुली मैं मंदिर तिरुपति जा रही हूं मुझे अपना दर्शन दे दो द ज्ञानी नोइंग फुली वेल द अपरा एंड द परा दे जस्ट मेडिटेट ऑन द परा लाइक दैट ओल्ड गोपी. There are quite a few brilliant, beautiful examples of these jnanis. Kunti. Kunti says, please, let me get more and more sorrow. Because when I get sorrow, you know what? Krishna comes on his own. I don't even have to call him. So Krishna is with me when I get sorrow, so give me more sorrow. Then Prahlad. Prahlada, poison, rocks, serpents, fire, Holika fire. Every possible means was used to eliminate them. But this bhakta, Nishkama bhakta, immersed in Bhagwan, he did not even feel any of these mayavik elements. Voilà. Beautiful example. There are many more, like, you know, even Mirabhai, Yudhishthir, they are all known to be Nishkama bhakta. I had sent a message to this group today, eagerly waiting to go through the most exhilarating of verses with all of you. Was that Sakama or Nishkama? So Bhagavan beautifully tells us, Chatur vidha bhajante maam jana sukritino arjuna
arto
jigyasur artarthi jnani cha bharatarshabha. And Bhagavan then says, of these four, the next verse,
Tesham jnani nitya yukta.
Tesham jnani nitya yukta.
Eka bhaktir vishishyate.
Eka bhaktir vishishyate.
Priyo hi jnani no tyartham.
Priyo hi jnani no tyartham.
Aham sacha mama priyaha.
Aham sacha mama priyaha.
Tesham jnani nitya yukta eka bhaktir vishishyate priyo hi jnani no tyartam aham sacha mama priyaha.
Tesham, among them, among who? Among the sukritinah, among the virtuous. Jnani vishishyate, the jnani, the one with the wisdom, is the best. And why does Bhagavan say this? He says because this jnani is nitya yuktaha. Nitya yuktaha, ever steadfast. Eka bhakti, with single pointed devotion. To ever steadfast on me. Eka bhakti on me. And then Bhagavan adds, priyo hi jnanino tyartham aham sacha mama priyaha. For the jnani, I am the most dear. I am the dearest. And because whatever Bhagavan says, no, whatever you give me, I will give you, reciprocate. So because for him, for that jnani, for her, I am the dearest, that jnani is dear to me. Atyartam. Atyartam means exceedingly, without limits. Without limits, dear. So we love our dog or our cat more than the wife. We love, or the husband, you know, if it is a lady. We love the wife more than the, or we love the wife lesser than the mother, or the husband lesser than the father. We love the mother lesser than the self. What about our love for Bhagavan? Each one of us has to find our own answer to this. So I'm talking about me, Srini, am I who sent this text today, the Sakama Bhakta, obviously Sakama Bhakta, no? Because I had this, I had this hope that more people would join, okay? Two, I had this hope that, you know, we will all listen to this and you'll go through this more attentively, right? So Sakama Bhakta, it was clearly not a Nishkama Bhakta asking that, sending that, you know, exhilarating verses of Bhagavad Gita. So that Sakama Bhakta is in, am I not dear to Bhagavan? There was a goal in writing this also, you know, that text message. That also makes it Sakama. We will find out in the next section. Thank you, Hari Om.
So we'll repeat today's verses.
Yeah.
13-17. Evi sarvamidam jagat mohitam nabi janati amebhya paramavyam evi yesha gunamai mama maya duratyaya mama evahi prapadyanti maya mitam partarantiti namam duskriti no mudaha prapadyante naradamaha. मायया प्रणत ज्ञानाः आसुरं भावमाश्रिताः चतुर्विधा भजन्ति मां जनासु कृतिनोर्जुना आर्तो जिज्ञासुरर्थार्थी ज्ञानी च भरतर्षभा तेषां ज्ञानी नित्ययुक्ता एकभक्तिर्विशिष्यते प्रियो हि ज्ञानिनोत्यार्थम् अहं स च मम प्रियः ओ असतो मा सद्गमया तमसो मा ज्योतिर्गमया मृत्योर्मा अमृतं गमया ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ
हरि ओम
couple of chats which I is archa from a maya of the lord what I didn't understand archa means
you know what I meant was is archa form in the temple the god
yeah absolutely yes he's the apara prakriti
Okay, I have another question. Is the Leela of the Lord same as a Maya of the Lord, or are they synonyms, or it is because of the Maya he makes a Leela, or is the other way around? The Leela of the Lord is a sport of the Lord. What?
See, the Leela is Maya. So Bhagavan says that I am the substratum, the changeless avyayam, the decayless, changeless. Imperishable substratum, which first through sattva, rajas, tamas, through the gunas, I emerge. That is the leela, that is the prakriti, that is the maya, is the first step of creation. And then through that, we saw in the previous satsang the other aspects of creation. So Bhagavan says that this prakriti, which is me alone, but my sattva, rajasic, tamasic expression, my leela. My Maya, Leela, Maya, Prakriti, all are same in this term.
They're synonyms, kind of.
They are synonyms.
Okay, thank you.
It is very refreshing every time.
That indeed it is Bhagavan's teaching, you know, it is every time you do it n number of times, it is refreshing.
Yes.
When I prepare for it, it is refreshing. Then when I am in the satsang, it is, yeah, absolutely. As many times as you read, and you also kind of, you have more things that quote unquote unveil themselves, you know, more, you realize more, you feel you know more. A lot of things become clearer. Okay, if there's no other thoughts, then we can say Hari Om and meet next Saturday. Thank you all. Hari Om. Please meet next Saturday. Thank you.